I'm Dr. Nikhila Bhagwat, and I've come all the way from Nasik, Maharashtra, to mingle with you, to listen to you, and after 5 very scholarly lectures and speeches, it is a hard task for me to keep you awake. So I have prepared for that also. But let us quickly go through ethics in teaching. I'm just going to run through my slides because everything has been talked about with details. So the tagline of the title is, do not play with fire, do not get burned. That means if we don't indulge into any kind of misconduct in research, then we need not fear anything. Because now research misconduct is not going to go unpunished. And then we can create good role models for our students as well. This is a very common, picture in most of the colleges and schools. Nowadays, in our part of the world, exams are going on. This is exam time. So what do we call this? Can we make a little interactive? What do we call this? Copying. Yes, a misconduct. In very scientific language or very professional language, we would say it is unfair, indulging into unfair practices. Right? So this is a misconduct for a student. Similarly, teachers also get involved in some misconduct. And I'm going to quickly tell you the 6 research misconducts, which are already talked about. Data falsification, fabrication. That means the research has never taken place and we have created the data on paper. This is data fabrication, which is a major misconduct in research. Second is plagiarism. We have already talked about plagiarism. I don't know from where this came. The second is redundant publication. That means when we break down our study into several parts, split it into several parts to create so many papers, it becomes redundant publication because then we are losing the crux of the study. We are losing the main soul of the study and then presenting it in different parts, and that loses the soul of the study. Then data fabrication, manipulating data to suit our hypothesis or to suit, the kind of maybe research results that we want, we tend to fabricate or manipulate the data. Then plagiarism, we have already talked about this. Passing on somebody else's idea as my own or your own is plagiarism. Then duplicate submission. When we submit the same paper, simultaneously to 2-3 journals, this is duplicate submission, which is not permitted in the research community. We must wait for the one particular journal to get back to us, and then only when they reject our paper, we can go to another journal. But normally we are in a hurry because we want to increase our APA, and therefore we, at the same time, give our paper to several journals, which is not permitted. Then comes duplicate publication. That means our own paper, when we, after 4 years, 5 years, try to get it published in some other journal, even that is a punishable offense. So all this is research misconduct. Then ethics are the things that keep us from research misconduct. And then what are ethics? Ethics are moral values. Ethics are golden rules. Ethics are principles or the commandments that, regulate or influence our behavior. Ethics are the rules that distinguish between right and wrong. Ethics are also called laws of conduct. But let us understand that ethics and laws are two different things sometimes. They are contradictory to each other. What can be lawful may not be ethical, and what can be ethical may not be lawful also. I will give you one example. During whatever the freedom fighters were doing was ethical. But since it was a British rule, it was unlawful. So there was a conflict there. Another very good example given by Dr. David Resnick. He has said that 2 people agree that murder is unethical. But they may not agree on having abortions abolished. Because for them, human being, the notion of human being is different. for those two different people. Similarly, in India, murder is not, is unlawful, but abortions we promote. You know, those anything that is unethical may not be lawful also. So what are ethics? Let us look at the smallest possible definition of ethics. Moral principle that govern a person's behavior or the conduct of any activity. And therefore, we look like this when we steal ideas from people. We look like robbers. We look like stealers. And therefore, these are the ethics. Quickly, I will say that these are the important things that ethics normally do. They prohibit any kind of misconduct. They promote the truth. They help to minimize error. They protect the intellectual property rights. They provide protection to human and animal subjects, because many a times in pure sciences, the research is conducted on human beings and animals, and a lot of cruelty is experienced. So they regulate. Then they encourage the values that are vital for collaborative work, because if we don't trust each other, we can't work together. So they encourage collaborative work. They guard quality and integrity of research. So the basic ethical principle, quickly I will go through, because I'm not going to take more time. This has been already discussed. Honesty, objectivity, integrity, carefulness. Carefulness in avoiding negligence. Then openness, sharing data, results, ideas, tools, and resources. Then respect for intellectual property, confidentiality, responsible publication, responsible mentoring. This is a very crucial area, because most of us, we are sitting here, could be research guides. And many a times, research guides tend to harass their research to scholars. So we have to be responsible mentoring and help to educate, mentor, and advise students. Not just ask them to redo and redo and redo without informing them what is exactly to be done. Then respect for colleagues. Non-discrimination. So discrimination against caste, creed, you know, gender. Many a times in India, we experience that being women. So social responsibility. So any research should always strive to promote the social good. But then research is research. That means many a times we have to borrow ideas. We have to develop upon a concept which has already been discussed. So many times we need to borrow ideas. So are there any ethical ways of doing? Yes, there are three ways of borrowing ideas. Firstly, summarize. You can summarize. If the same concept or idea is described in a full page or maybe 1.5 pages, you can summarize it in your own words in a small para. You can paraphrase. You can same length of words, but you can use your own words to explain the idea. And you can quote. You can take as it is, whatever data, text, verbatim, or pictures, everything. But for this, you need citation. For all these three things, you need citations. I think previous teachers have already talked about APA, MLA style. So we know the standard citation styles. And this is what I think Madam was talking in her first lecture, that plagiarism is not now going to be limited. So what are the plagiarism standards? For, I think, according to my knowledge, when you give away your paper for publication, the plagiarism should be below 10%. When you go for thesis submission, it should be, there are different norms of different universities, but on an average, should be below 30%. And why this 30% permissible? Because we have a second chapter, review of literature, which normally is made of borrowed things, and therefore this limit is kept to 30%. And now there has been a UGC guideline that if now any publication is going to exceed 60% and more of plagiarized ideas, then you may have to, you know, not only your degrees, but your jobs are also at a stake. So we must be very, very careful. Now, these are my references, and this is something I'm going to now keep you awake. I have some, come here. I have some, incentives also for you. These are chocolates. I'm going to conduct a small research test, very interesting, very simple. I need answers from the audience, and the correct answer, first correct answer, will get a chocolate. So shall we begin? Okay, the first question is, if you are interested to perceive yourself as a scientist, then what sort of changes you will prefer in yourself? It is an MCQ, there are four answers, you have to pick the right answer. I will read out the answers. Full of scientific excitement, development of scientific attitude, training under the guidance of a scientist, and registration for PhD degree. What is the right answer according to you? B. Development of scientific attitude. Shall we go further? Question number two. A group of experts in a specific area of knowledge assembled at a place and prepared a syllabus for a new course. The process may be termed as seminar, conference, workshop, or symposium. Workshop. Who said that first? Okay. The right answer is workshop. The third is, if Mohan is represented by the code KMFYL, then count will be represented by which of the following? A, B, C, D. Correct. And what is the logic? Yeah, we have gone two letters behind. So similarly here also, we have to go two letters behind. Thank you for your cooperation. Question number four. On the spot research aimed at the solution of an immediate problem is called fundamental research, action research, Okay, the gentleman there, action research. Applied research is also known as field research, fundamental research. Okay, second row, madam here. The sum of the ages of two persons, A and B, is 50. 5 years ago, the ratio of their ages was 5:3. The present age of A and B are? No. I want A, B, C, D, quick. No, right, she's right, A. So 5 years back, they were 25 and 15. So 5:3, right? Okay, the next question is, which number will come next to the following sequence? I'm sorry for the mistake here. Following sequence, 2, 6, 12, 20, 30, 42, 56, and? Yeah, the gentleman here, yes, it is 70. D, 70. What is the logic, sir? Yeah, here, please raise your hand, sir. Yeah. The next is, when two or more successive footnotes. No? Please stand. Yeah, it is IBID. And this is the logic. Etal means there are other writers. Opposite means immediately preceding reference. Loxit is immediately preceding dicto reference with the same page number. And IBID is same reference appearing previously in the text. Six persons A, B, C, you can use your paper and pencil. Six persons A, B, C, D, E, and F are standing in a circle. B is between F and C. A is between E and D. F is to the left of D. Who is between A and F? Who said C? See, you have to raise your hands. You are losing your chocolates. Yes, sir. You have got a chocolate before? No. That yellow shirt. It is C, D.
The next is, reptile is to lizard as flower is to?
Daisy.
Yes, daisy, correct? Daisy, but you have already got the chocolate. And nobody said, okay. Give it to her friend then. Daisy, right. Where do you provide a step-by-step account of what the researcher and the participants did during the research study? Design? Yes, procedure. He gets the chocolate. A good researcher lays his hands on specific area and tries to understand it in minute details, several areas, and tries to understand them at fundamental level, any area as long as manpower and funding are available in plenty, all of the above. Yes, 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 very much. Specific area and tries to understand it in minute details. The next is, which is an example of negative correlation? Now it is listed here, you tell me, which is the negative correlation?
D.
Who said D?
D?
Yes, very much. D, because negative correlation is when one grows, other decreases. An increase in population will lead to a shortage of food grains. Very much the D. Next is, when the researcher uses the information already available and analyze these to make a critical evaluation, that is called? Who said C? He said C. It is analytical. Qualitative approach to research is concerned with the subjective assessment of. Qualitative approach. Yes, D. Qualitative analysis approach is always about attitudes, opinions, and behavior. Okay? So, sir gets the chocolate. The next one is, when each member of a population has an equally likely chance of being selected, this is called?
D.
Yes, correct. But you have already got one chocolate, sir, right? No? Okay. Okay, third row. Yes. It is equal probability selection sample. We are moving towards the end now, only two chocolates are remaining. Which of the following is the source of primary data? All of them, yes. Jagannathan. All of the above. Yes, all these are primary data sources. Personal records, personal diaries, autobiographies, historical and legal documents, all of the above, yes. And the last question is, the research should not be carried out with blindfolded eyes. The meaning of this phrase is? Yes, please get up. She gets the chocolate. It is all of the above. So one should be free of biases. One should be free of personal limitations, and one should be separated from personal ideologies. All of the above is required to carry out a research with an objective mind. And with this, I conclude my presentation and thank you for this opportunity. Thank you very much.